incredible, untouchable niggas spitting venom out his body with the dopest flows. And wonder why the lines around the corner, cause the little motherfucker has the dopest shows. So one time for my independent women and all the single mothers who be getting that cake. Two times for my dog pulling triggers and my niggas in the kitchen that be flipping that way. East Coast, West Coast, Midwest, Dirty South, then we took it all around the world. I got fans in retirement homes to teenagers and little bitty boys and girls. Dropping lyrical bombs up in your hood, non-stop, and I'ma hit them till the block explode. Hip-hop, R&B, pop-tart, what you want? I even got a little rock and roll.
The most creative, original, got them taking subliminal. Cause they can't get what I got. They want it so bad, $4 million pad and enough to retire off two albums. Go on, wave your white flags, I'm hot.
And every time I rhyme, I'm putting rappers in the ground with lines that got them hooked like dope. They gotta make up their mind because they running out of time and now I'm about to make them choke.
Better turn your stereo louder, listen up and let me preach. Let's get arrested for disturbing the peace. Come on, come on.
Man, this disturbing the peace shit getting on my nerve, boy, I tell you the truth, you know what I'm saying? While he doing shows, I'm in these streets, you know what I'm saying? While he on TV, I'm in these streets. And then my broad and my kid walk around singing it. Well, if they sing another verse, why I sway, you know what I'm saying? I'm on another level, though. I got a car wash, I got a shop on Old National, I got my own record label, you heard of. Posse family cartel, you know what I'm saying? We real. Who this nigga think he is?
I'm a household name with games spitting out of my mouth at all times. I spit it out and about and spit it out of the south until they recognize the danger sign. So feel a tingle in your spine by the way I talk. And it's pimping in my blood, you can tell by the way I walk. Ooh lord, more style than a barbershop. Call the cop, people in the way when I ball a block. Little do they know that I'm calling shots. And I'm not to be fucked with. If you see me come around the corner, then duck quick. Perpetrators can suck dick. I try to tell them, but they don't wanna listen. I try to shine them, but they don't wanna glisten. While the hi-hat keeps on ticking, and the kick drum keep on pumping, I'm dumping on the closest fools. Cause rules were made to be broken, but you can't make broken rules. Hear what I'm saying, or heard what I said. Hear what they playing, cause through this music, I'ma still be heard if I'm dead. Call your producers, cause I'm hurting these beats. I said it once, I'll say it twice. Bitch, disturbing the peace. Come on.
Yeah, folks. The King of the Kings has spoken. ATL, shout it.
How the devil are you, Matthew? You well?
Hello, mate. How are you? Opening with a bit of old Luda there. Very nice.
Yeah, no, it's a good choice. Was it you who came up with the old decision to drop a bit of Luda today? Or?
Yeah. I've been... why was I thinking about Ludacris? I wasn't thinking about Ludacris. No, I was thinking about Timbaland.
Of course, it's a Timbo beat, isn't it?
I think that's one of his best beats, actually. Mainly built off bits of Walk On By by Isaac Hayes from Hot Buttered Soul, one of my favourite records.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a banger. Yeah, it's a very good record. That's the one with
today,
that's
actually.
The 15-minute version of When I Get Back to Memphis, isn't it?
Yeah, By the Time I Get to Phoenix.
By the Time I Get to Phoenix, sorry.
Yeah, that's the last track on the album. It's about 18 minutes long and it's just Hayes slowly talking his way through a traumatic journey. Bloody brilliant. There's also a really good version by Nick Cave.
Have I heard that? I feel like I have.
Takes on a slightly different tone to Isaac Hayes' one.
More jovial.
Yeah, it's more of a more of an up-tempo club anthem.
Bit of a show tune.
Oh, it is indeed. Yeah. What have you been up to this week, mate, then? What's been happening?
Arsehole, to be honest with you. I've been working my little socks off and that's about all you're getting out of me, to be honest. How you been this week? What have you been up to?
I see you've also found time to hang up your signed Ainsley Harriott picture.
Yeah, I've got big Ainsley on the wall. Yeah. Happy succulent sizzles.
Have you been watching his show on a Sunday on ITV?
Is it the one where he's in the Mediterranean?
Yes.
What a show.
I mean, I fucking hate cookery shows. I think they're the pits.
No, but...
he's just sheer joy.
He's just like...
everything is great when you're Ainsley.
Completely unflappable.
Yeah, he just... yeah, he is. And like, he went to Petra. Did you see the episode in Petra where they...
No.
At the end of The Last Crusade? And he just stepped into the architecture of Petra, and he just had to take a moment, and he just stood against the wall and had a little cry, and it was just a beautiful.
Hey, what a guy!
Just a beautiful thing to see. He just had a lovely time. But so I've been. Let's get into it. I'll open the burning discussion of the day. So I've been thinking about the thing about Timbaland, because I'm a big fan, I bought a couple of bits and bobs, did a little bit of record shopping, picked up some Timbo classics.
Mm-hmm.
And it reminded me of an absolute favourite that I forgot about. And then I was like, especially considering, you know, the previous discussions we've had over the last few weeks about culture and appropriation. And I was thinking, is Indian flute appropriate? Because it's fucking great, but like, there's a bit where there's like, I mean, it's a great track. We'll play it after. In fact, should we play the track now? For the people, and then, because otherwise this might be contextless.
Do you want to give it a little proper intro? So buy time while I find it.
Okay. So this is me buying time. I mean, this is a track by Timbaland and Magoo called Indian Flute. And so for those new to the Timbo camp, Timbaland used to work regularly with a guy called Magoo. And they did kind of comps. I think they were called Under Construction, weren't they? The main ones, Construction 1 and 2. And Magoo was like his go-to rapper, and I've never really known why. He's not particularly bad, but he's certainly not particularly good. But yeah, Indian Flute was one of their sort of big hitters from one of these comps. And I love it, but I don't know
if it's okay to say that out loud.
Yeah, I'm not sure how appropriate it is.
Let's get into it.
Sing it to me. But I can't understand a word you're saying.
Buddy, must you feel it? Hey, I'm much now.
Baby, I've been eyeing you way from afar.
Daddy, I can't miss up. Good day, huh?
Thanks for the props, but to me, you the star.
Now then, I can't miss up the bull and the jar.
Let's get it on tonight while I wait for tomorrow.
Come on, tell me, show me how bad you are.
I just only a mini Piakia.
Oh, I got my eyes on you. Baby, let me tell you that you are the truth. I love your Indian food. Oh, da da do da da do da do. Sing it to me.
You say I'm out of me, let me time.
Sing it to me.
You say I'm out of here, who I.
Sing it to me.
Let us get you a little
bit. But I can't understand the word you're saying.
I'll be the banana make you a girl.
Wanna sleep next to ooh, when it's 3 all that's on the TV is kung fu. Fuck around and a nigga end up on top of you. You ain't the first, best believe for sure, it's been a few.
Come on, man, you know because I'm feeling you.
I just signed a yay, prr, ta, hoo, oh.
I got my eyes on you. Baby, let me tell you that you are the truth.
I direct your every move like a young Benny Boom. After beating up your womb, no need to put on perfume, baby girl, you leaving soon. Nobody gotta know your thong was maroon. You know, after creeping out my room, just so your man don't assume. Sing it to him. Sing it to him.
Let's just fade it down there. I think we've. Magoo just used the line. Right. So actually, I was thinking about Indian flute and whether it was appropriate. And it doesn't. It's certainly not aged as well as I thought it might have done. But did Magoo just use the line after beating up your womb as a sex reference? Or did I just mishear that / make it up because it sounds really funny?
I think you might have. I think you might have said it.
Well. If I'd have known, aged 18 and shy, that I could have pulled by asking women if I could beat up their womb, I would have been well in.
Do you think that ever worked for Magoo? First off, his name's Magoo.
I'd argue that nothing really ever worked on the track for Magoo, so I don't know why it'd be any different in the club.
Yeah.
But yeah, that seems less appropriate. But then it's like, I mean, Timbaland does admit he doesn't know what she's saying. But then there is a bit where I think Magoo pretends to speak Indian. Or another language of God knows what.
Yeah.
And I don't know what he's supposed to be speaking, so I don't know how we could even cross-check that, but it sounds like he might have made up some things that sounded like... And that's kind of a... I mean, obviously it wasn't a Timbaland beat, but that's kind of a dry run for the just a little bit, the 50 Cent track. It's sort of like a...
I guess so.
An outlier for that. But there was that point where kind of the Eastern instrumentation just came into hip hop big time.
Yeah.
And everyone was sampling Indian flute and or Indian flutes and all that.
Yeah.
And I mean, I don't know. Is that appropriate? Like, I don't want to get all fun police on it, but that one, I mean, I think I'm actually more upset that there's the term beat up your womb in that one.
Yeah, that one does sound a bit, sounds like the old teenage joke of saying you're going to play Womb Raider. it's a V12 again.
Wasn't that an actual dodgy a dodgy film-based porn?
It does sound like a porn parody, doesn't it?
Was it not one?
It probably was.
Because they did go overboard on the titles for those. There was absolute showboaters. Playmate of the Apes, always a classic. That's a real one. That was one. Pretty sure that was an actual one. Rambone.
Oh, that sounds rough.
Yeah, that doesn't even sound pleasant. That doesn't even sound like it's going to be like a bit of a laugh. That sounds like something that someone who would attempt to beat up your womb would.
It does sound pretty Magoo, to be fair.
classic Magoo.
Magoo.
Where did Magoo go? Did he go into making porn parodies?
I think he was doing that from the start, wasn't he? He was just always doing it.
just turned out there was a beat in the background, so they put it on a Timberland compilation.
But it's interesting that you say this, because it's no one really made a big deal of it. I don't know if it were to happen right now, people would or not. Because, I mean, there was like that really offensive Eminem one. Asked like that.
Oh, God, that's someone who's doing that stupid voice for the whole track.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's awful. And the video...
But, I mean, that voice was meant to be taking the mick out of like this dog character, which takes the mick out of, you know, like a type of accent.
That's right. The dog was like a stand-up sketch on a stand-up comic show, wasn't it? Or something stupid, but... But there's that whole album and the album afterwards. There's loads of tracks where Eminem puts on that same strange sort of, I don't even know what accent he's trying to pretend to do. And then there's another classic appropriation beat is Busta Rhymes' A-Rab Money.
Cool.
With that weird auto-tuned hook, which is just... But these things are all just like, and they say A-Rab Money.
That one was produced by A-Rab Music, though.
Yeah, but he's not...
Is he not from the Middle East?
He's not from the Arab Emirates or anything. I think he's from Brooklyn.
Oh, right.
Like,
yeah. But is his, like, parentage or, like, you know, ancestry?
I don't think so. He actually... A-Rab Music performed the worst set I've ever seen at Outlook Festival.
Okay.
I think it was the year I was there with the Butters guys. I think it was 2015, was that? But it was just like tear out bro step for an hour. And it was the hardest, heaviest, noisiest, shreddiest stuff I've ever heard.
Mm.
And I was like, is this A-Rab Music? And everyone was like, yeah, pretty sure. And I was like, I hope I've got that wrong, but I'm pretty sure it was him. It was garbage. Absolute garbage.
I mean, I've not really seen him since.
That's true. He produced that whole Joe Budden album.
Not really seen him since.
What about Bangladesh? What's his heritage?
He does make some great beats. I don't know his heritage, to be honest. But Bangladesh is a very good name for making bangers.
Yeah, or appropriating Indian flutes.
Yeah.
But... No, so I don't know. I'm not sure. I mean, Indian flute is still a great beat, but maybe it's time to put it away. What do you think? What are your views on it?
I feel like Indian flute, it's fun. It's a fun song, apart from the bit about being up your womb. But I don't know. Is it time to put it to bed? Oh, it's not really being too offensive, or is it? I don't know.
I'm not sure. It's just like, it's the bits where people... Because there's another track where it happens is There's a track on the first Grand Hustle compilation. There's a track called Grand Hustle Mafia. And I think it's Young Dro rapping on it. And he says a line like, bitches can't even believe I'm speaking Japanese. And then in the background, you know how they used to overdub, like they'd echo what they said or whatever?
Yeah, yeah.
He just sort of goes, mwah, mwah, mwah.
God.
It's so blatantly not actually Japanese. And it's just, it's fucking, it's awful. But there was like a point where it just kind of happened loads. People like, you know, there'd be like Eastern samples sort of doing little sort of ad libs in different languages that probably weren't fact checked. And this is in the days before Google Translate. But then, yeah. Indian flute was what I was thinking about this week. And I was like, you know, with all the talk of things like, all the kind of, you know, everyone being a lot more conscious at the moment of cultural appropriation and stuff. Because it's not really offensive, but then it's not really respectful or contextualizing any of the things it's using.
I hear you.
Not convinced Magoo is speaking a real language in the bit where he flips on that verse. But then is it harmless? I don't know.
I don't know. I think it could potentially be harmless. Harmful, sorry.
Anything with Magoo on is potentially
harmful. Anything with Magoo on is probably harmful. should I try and look for a good Magoo song?
I don't think it's only a 2-hour show.
It'll be something by Timbaland and Magoo, which is an Indian flute.
Has he done anything without Timbaland?
He's featured on like a Missy song.
Yeah, but was that not because it was produced by Timbaland?
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, there you go. Okay, I'll sit tight.
I mean, I can't really find anything. Jesus, he's got so many albums through mixtapes.
Are you on Spotify?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, there's loads of weird, like none of his official stuff, because none of the Timbaland and Magoo stuff's on there.
Oh, right.
It's like all these weird, we've had a hard drive full of stuff, or this is out of copyright, I don't know.
Oh, but this is like insane. This is like he's never stopped recording. I don't know what to do about it. God. Yeah, let's go for something else. Jesus.
He had so many bars.
Oh, wait. No, we've got All Your. That's a good song.
Which one's
should I go for it?
Let's do it.
Is it Tweet? Can't remember. Anyway, let's go for a bit of this.
So all the ones across the world. We can't diss y'all. We gotta love you. That's real. To all my ladies in lingerie, never underage, who stay getting paid, who like to take trips with the sun and shade, to my women who love to ball out and spend all that money till you're all out. I feel like a pimp with a different pimp game, with a different pimp name, with a little pimp fame. I'm loaded with cash, loaded with class, loaded with a lot of things, even got a gat loaded for that ass. I love my mind, love my soul, love my body. I don't drink or smoke, that's why I love my body. You might catch me chilling with a little short hottie, with a little piercing on her body. Yes, I get it popping, especially overseas. Japanese girls even love my beef. They say, Timbaland, we love you. We love that dope things that you do. Even in London, they say, Tim, we love ya. They even call me things like Wicked and the effing governor. That's why I can't forget y'all. That's why I had to make this roll call.
This is for one and all.
They cherish the day. Yo, Thomas frequently say, bus stopping and whiskey popping to the Marvin and Gaye.
Sonny, don't play tomorrow, but live for the day. Sonny, here's a quarter for that groovy arcade.
His verse just get cut off by Timbaland.
Game. So crappy with things, Pac-Man King looking the same. Haters, get more familiar who you robbing for change.
You Smash,
a.k.a. Tyler Durden's the name.
Verse just got cut off by Timbaland there. Timbaland just sung over a big verse.
You went like, that's a bad thing.
No, but you said you were going to play a good song. And then if you got one by Timbaland, you were going to find one.
And then I didn't. And I'm glad I didn't.
But this is also, this is
good.
See, this doesn't feel as a folk. This has got a clearly Eastern flex to it on that pipe sample. But this doesn't feel as sort of exploitative as the other one.
I mean, I'm enjoying the irony of you complaining about misappropriating Eastern heritage while wearing a silk kimono.
This is a gift.
This whole thing?
Yeah, look at this. I think on Indian food, I actually think this is helping me down my problems.
Cause I hate the game, I hate the glory. I could be with Charlie, would be another story.
Who's that rapping there? Is that what's her name?
Probably would have been Missy.
Take my cash, take my name, put it up in bright lights. I ain't got a damn right.
Probably Miss Jade.
Yeah, Miss Jade, that's who it is. Yeah, it is.
But I'm gonna be the man in charge in due time.
I forgot how good Miss Jade is. She had some well good tracks.
She had that one massive track. Was it Ching Ching?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, that was huge.
I think one of her only... Well, not one of her only problems. She obviously had a few because she disappeared off the map. Mm. Apart from the Beat Club fiasco. I think the problem Miss Jade had is she just sounded too much like Eve.
Yeah.
Like, she just sounded like Eve on a Timbaland beat and there was just nothing to differentiate her. And she was never going to catch up to Eve at that point. Mm. Like... Yeah, I think
that's kind of the unfortunate thing about sort of women in hip hop, because it's like you can have like a bunch of men that all sound the same and they can all break through and be fine, but for women it's like you can only have like a certain few.
Yeah, there's literally space for one.
Yeah, it's like they all have to meet a certain style that's different from the other. You can't have two that are similar.
Although, sounding like Notorious B.I.G., fuck Gorilla Black.
He still had like a number one single.
Well, yeah, I think that was it though. He sounded like Notorious B.I.G. and everyone thought, wow, he sounds like Biggie. And then everyone was like, wait, he sounds like Biggie. But I think that beat has actually helped me pin down why I thought Indian Flute felt more inappropriate. Mm. I think it's just the fact that they use another language and don't make any effort to actually reference what it is the language is saying. Mm. Admittedly, Timbaland does actually sing, I don't know, I haven't got a clue what you're saying, which I got time for. And then Magoo does a bit that I'm not convinced he's speaking another language, and it's a bit lazy, whereas that just takes a bit of sound and uses it in a beat, and it's kind of more... Mm. And it feels more... that one sounded more like it was part of the beat, whereas the other one just sounded like a beat and they chucked an Indian flute on top.
Well, I'm sure that the vocal bit in that song, isn't that a tweet?
Don't know, maybe?
I'm not sure. I have a feeling it was, but I might be wrong.
But, yeah, well, that's... I wouldn't say they're settled, but I'm happier. I think I understand more of why it makes me less than comfortable. Well, not less than comfortable. It doesn't make me uncomfortable at all. That's not the truth. It doesn't make me uncomfortable, but it just got me thinking.
I think there's a balance between... appropriation and appreciation. I think having it work well and not just center around the song in an offensive way is a good way to appreciate the original song by putting it into a good song that you've made, that you've used to sample. And appropriation is just making shit for shit's sake and doing it bad and then making shit jokes about it.
So you're saying Indian Flute's okay?
I'm going to say no. even without the appropriation, I'm still going to say no. It's not very good.
Is it just because Magoo doesn't get interrupted mid-verse?
I think because Magoo gets more than 8 bars.
Yeah, it's not appropriate. Having none of it. And from there, well, shall we jump on to, we'll go two in a row for me. Shall we jump on to the renaming of labels?
Yeah, that
flows quite nicely off the back of that.
Why is that bothering you so much?
Bothering me. No, it was just I noticed this week across the musical spectrum, the XL sub label Whitey's rebranded.
What are they called themselves now? I've not actually looked this up.
No, I forgot to do... Well, I didn't forget to. I had to do that DIY before we started recording, so I didn't get a chance to look that one up.
But Alex,
whilst you look that up, I'll go through the other labels. So One Little Indian has rebranded as well, which is the label Bjork is on, I believe.
She would have been. I'm not sure if she still is. Maybe still is. I'm not sure.
What have they rebranded to again?
I think just One Little Record Company, I think they're
that's
called.
That's it, One Little, yeah, which is not, I mean, fair play on rebranding, but that's not a very good name.
Yeah. Why has it changed its name to AD93?
Come again?
AD93.
Oh, is that the Whitey's rebrand?
Yeah.
Right, and yeah, and Urban Nerds have dropped Urban and just become Nerds or Nerds Collective, I believe. All in response to obviously stuff we covered on the previous shows, like Black Lives Matter movement and the civil rights stuff around that. But yeah, I just thought it was an interesting thing that's taken hold, and it kind of comes into the appropriation thing of where does it stop being appropriate and start being like the explanation as to why Whitey's rebranded was interesting, because originally It was named Whitey's as in white labels, because it was like XL's white label spin-off. But then as the label runner, whose name I forget, was saying, like, he was like, that's not really the function of the label now either way. So it was kind of rebranded on that level too.
Yeah. Makes sense.
But I mean, One Little Indian is fair enough renaming it, because the logo used to be a feather, didn't it?
It was. I think it was like a bird dressed as a sort of an American native.
Yeah.
With Robert Chief's head.
So probably shouldn't have even been called an Indian 2 or 3 years ago, let alone now. Like, that's quite a dated and not always well received term for a Native American person. But then it's kind of like we rebranded back in January.
That's very true. Yeah.
And that was I mean, we dropped the souffle because the little hyphenated E just fucked up every digital or accounting piece of software we had.
Yeah, it's like if you're not working with like an Irish or French distributor, then you're absolutely ruined.
Yeah, the amount of things that we got credited as Purple City Suffle on. Or South Purple City Souffle. But But yeah, the logo, obviously our old logo was the chef with an afro and a big souffle chef hat on, hence where the souffle came from. But originally, I don't know if I ever told you this actually, how I designed the logo.
You might have done while I was absolutely smashed.
Yeah, sounds about right. Sounds about how we usually roll. But no, originally it was based. So one of my heroes growing up, one of my favorite films is Enter the Dragon. On the subject of appropriation of Eastern culture, but no, I loved Enter the Dragon, and it was based on Jim Kelly in Enter the Dragon. And I designed it when I was at uni, and I mean, I was in the throes of an eating disorder, so I don't know if that's why everything I was drawing at the time was heavily food related. I sort of look back at that now. I look at all the stuff I did in that year creatively, and it was all kind of psychedelic food related stuff. And I was heavily suffering from anorexia and doing loads of gear. So I wonder if there's some sort of strange, not too subtle subtext.
Was there like lots of gear in the animations as well? Was it like rhubarb and custard next to rhubarb and custard?
No, I weren't that good. No, I weren't that skilled. My university animation was more anything I could do within the time frame. I just did that. But
of course.
But no, I started writing a film, which was because our logo was always called Alamo Jones, and I was writing like a blaxploitation sort of film called Alamo Jones about a slave who escaped from a farm and went and set up a kitchen in Hell's Kitchen in New York, and it just kind of caught up with him. As an elderly guy in the 60s, so he escaped, you know, he somehow is living older than... And it was, yeah, it was kind of like a Jim Kelly vehicle, even though Jim Kelly had died by the time I was writing it, but it was just, you know, it was an exercise for me in doing that. And I drew him as part of that, and then I knew it was a really good design, and then Grime Daily tried to buy it off me actually for merch.
Okay.
And I outright refused. I always like, because Jim Kelly originally, in the original setup for Enter the Dragon, Jim Kelly was supposed to be John Saxon's role. So he was going to have a much bigger part as a black actor. But apparently John Saxon's agent put his foot down and was like, no, we switched these two over. And because Jim Kelly was going to kind of be like the sidekick to Bruce Lee and the kind of maverick gambler.
Yeah.
John Saxon was going to be the Vietnam vet who's, you know, on the run.
Mm-hmm.
But they flipped them because John Saxon's agent booted off, basically. So it was kind of that. I just liked that it embodied the underdog thing. But then, yeah, the Afro in itself is a sort of a particular symbol of a certain era in the civil rights and stuff. And I, apart from the souffle thing being an absolute nightmare, and as our new designer Jack pointed out to me so kindly, our logo didn't actually say the name of the brand on anywhere.
Yeah, I always thought about that, but I never said anything.
Cheers for bringing it up.
You think of, like, you know, a marketing graduate would point these things out, but turns out I didn't.
Is Jack a marketing graduate?
No, I am.
All right. you never mentioned that before, either. But, yeah, I started to feel like that wasn't really our logo to have, or mine in particular.
Of course, background is that you started Purple City and then, you know, I joined shortly after.
Yeah, I suppose that is, yeah. Well, I don't know, I always feel like we started it together. Because we kind of agreed to do it and said we were doing it, and then you went off to Tunisia, so I just kind of got cracking. But we'd already talked about it and kind of, like, I'd already said about the name and the idea, and you were on board with it. So it was always, I feel like it was us starting it, but then it just, purely because of geography, it was just easier for me to get on at the beginning there. And obviously I knew Zach to start with, so it was like
that was it, because like the first release was 2016 and I moved there into Tunisia in 2016.
Yeah. The fact that we've done two releases in 4 years.
Sign of a good label.
Yeah.
They haven't released any Magoo yet, so that's good.
I mean, yeah, we haven't let Magoo get his 7 bars in. and we're not called One Plantation Indian. So, you know, we're on the right track. I feel we're on the right track.
Oh, man.
But, so that was part of the... But, I mean, yeah, now I feel we definitely rebranded at the right time, and I don't think I'd have been comfortable carrying that logo any further had we still had it even now. I think we probably would have rebranded this month if we hadn't have already started rebranding 6 months ago and obviously got it finished just before Christmas.
Yeah.
But it's an interesting one because obviously I know none of these labels, same as us, they all have a personal reason for why they're called what they're called. But there comes a time to perhaps put it down. But then I don't know. At the same time, part of me is like the Whitey's one. The reason I found the Whitey's one so interesting is because that one had a very clear justification as to why it was called Whitey's, and it wasn't, you know, like the One Little Indian, using the term Indian in that context is questionable regardless of your personal story to your label. But I don't know, the Whitey's one was interesting. And Urban Nerds, I mean, the urban thing is always, that's always been a contentious one to me. Like,
yeah. I mean, I've found it as that, but it just always has, for whatever reason, been the unifying term of black music targeted to black audiences.
Yeah, but was it not a term made up by white people to categorize that music?
Was. Yeah, it probably was, yeah.
Yeah. Maybe we should roll into Wiley's What You Call It. Because I believe he references the term urban in What You Call It.
It does. What a swift segue that is.
I thought that was quite good. Yeah, I just thought of that.
Yeah, well done.
Really, I'm just gasping for another beer. So I would have said any shit. Let's put Magoo on and go get a drink.
I'm going to do that. Wait, he uses a U instead of a Y-O-U. God, this is hard to find.
It's on Treading on Thin Ice. Just search Treading on Thin Ice. It's like track 6, I think. Failing that, we can get Pies on. Pies is my favourite Wiley tune.
It's a banger, to be fair.
What you call it? Garage? Garage? What you call it? Urban? What you call it? Two step?
Tell us what you call it, garage.
I don't care about garage. Listen to this, it don't sound like garage. Who told you that I make garage? Willie Cat's got his own sound, it's not garage. Make it in the studio and not in the garage. Here in London, there's a sound called garage. But this is my sound, it sure ain't garage. I've heard they don't like me in garage, cause I use their scene to make my own sound. The Eskimo sound is mine, recognize it's mine. You can't claim what's mine, it's mine. Time to bait you up, I don't hate you, but some of you have got a problem. I'm putting you out of business, why is that a problem? What's your problem? What the heck, my name is Problem, remember?
What you call it, garage?
Think that I'm stupid. I got brains, I can never be stupid. You can never use my name to make your ends jam. I won't turn up or stay at home with a girl and jam. You can't threaten me with no bad man talk. I'm not scared, sorry man, but I've seen so much. Now I don't give a monkey's room from treat to treat just like monkeys. Who influenced me to be funky? Who influenced me to make Esky beat? I make Esky girls and Esky boys move their feet to the sound. You can hear, I hear you trying to stop my record sales, record deals, but the bell can't hold the wasting. If it gets too big and it's trembling, then pop, it blows up and we win. I'm winning, ready to say my goodbyes. Goodbye to the man who don't like me, goodbye to the woman who don't like me, goodbye to the fingers pointing at me, goodbye to the promoters that hate me, goodbye to the people that's hassling me, cause I'm turning over a new leaf. Get sharp like a knife in a sheath, stay sharp like a knife cutting beef. Cut the strings, there's no grief. If you don't cut the strings, there's more grief. See, I get the impression I'm not wanted, so I'm leaving your scene. That's what you wanted, that's what I wanted. I'm on my way now, wish me luck, I'm doing my thing now. To the fans, let's go, everyone who likes this, let's go, everyone who likes that, go that way,
go that way, go that way, go that way, go that way, go that way, go that way.
Everyone who likes this, come this way,
come this way.
Let's go this way,
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 let's go this way.
I'm carrying weight, I break everybody down, take everybody down. Any crew, any sound, any MC who's in my way, I break down. I can show you now, it's all changed round. I remember things were the other way round, but the world got colder and it changed round. I go to every manor and it's all changed round. I want everybody to follow this sound, so don't deny the power of my empire. When I'm here, I strike back with my empire. No more crew, so what we got an empire. Roll deep empire, high flower, high power. Yo, I'm a compulsory rebuyer. Go to the shops and I spend them, buy what I want, and this is roll deep empire. If you work hard, then you can be a buyer like me.
Absolute tune, Matthew.
Absolute treat. Yeah, I haven't heard that in a minute, actually. Yeah, enjoying it. I was enjoying it. I've enjoyed Godfather 3, actually.
So I've still not got around to hearing that.
Yeah, yeah, I'm rating it.
Is it a good one, yeah?
It is. I think I prefer it to Godfather 2. Godfather 2 was a bit scrappy and felt like a bunch of stuff that was kind of just laying around. Whereas this one feels a little more focused.
Yeah, it feels like it's just a weird time to be releasing it. I mean, I don't know, like,
I mean, with Wiley, is that really worth saying? This is a man who once dumped an entire XL signed album on Zippy Share to piss people off.
Oh, yeah.
Along with 400 spare tunes or whatever.
I do love that he called it Zip Files and it just looks like an offcut from the X-Files pilot.
Do you remember when Periscope first came about? I think it was Periscope.
Yeah.
And he just Periscoped his day, all day, every day, for months.
I don't remember him doing that, but
it was amazing. It was just like him boiling eggs. He left his phone in the middle of the park whilst he went jogging around the park for an hour. So you just like catch him just sort of sailing past every so often. It was great. It was one of those classic. You can't tell if he's really ahead of the game and actually sort of doing it on purpose or if it's just him being Wiley. Like, so what's been burning you up this week, Ashley? What's been on your radar?
I guess very loosely related to the others, we can talk about this new trend of, like, people blocking their friends on Facebook.
Is that a trend?
Like, there's, like, a new uptick of people blocking friends on Facebook because of them not sort of siding on a Black Lives Matter view, or, you know, being an All Lives Matter champion, and therefore...
Yeah, I mean, the way to progress as a society and change is to ignore everyone who doesn't agree with you.
I kind of... yeah, I mean, so normally I would say it's worth reasoning, but there are some people that are beyond reason.
Look, I'm a member of two lowest off Facebook groups. I say shut the whole fucking platform down. There's no point trying to talk to these fucking idiots.
God, imagine if lowest off Facebook groups took down Zuckerberg. Imagine
they must be doing a fair bit of Facebook value generating because people just don't get off it. I mean, I'll have a little look around in a bit. But yeah, so what set this off for you? Who do you know or what have you seen that's been kind of...
I don't know. I just keep seeing and hearing people being like, oh, I just had to block them. And it's like, oh, how long have you known them? It's like, years? It's like, right. And you didn't know this at the time? No. Interesting. So it just seems to be quite a common thing to hear now. Whereas, like, it sounds very sort of, you know, the sort of thing that you'd hear secondary school kids do, or, you know, that kind of vibe. And it's just become ever growing lately.
I mean, I've got to be honest, I don't obviously, well, as most people our age know, the whole snowflake generation thing is obviously some bullshit. And I hate all that. I hate all that kind of branding of people as snowflakes because they pay attention or actually care about something.
Yeah, I think it's bad that the term woke has been given.
Yeah, that's now a negative.
It's a negative. It's like, why is that a negative thing to be conscious of the world around you and the people that are around you as well?
But I do think that. Some I see it a lot with younger people who I know, and they do. Some of them do really seem averse to any form of resistance or any basic level of conflict resolution. Mm. Like, I understand safe spaces and those sorts of things actually really being useful.
Yeah,
but I do think there is a tendency in some people to just go straight to them when things aren't working.
Yeah,
and that's not the point of a safe space. Like,
yeah, there is a bit of a 0 to 100 kind of. Yeah, there's a middle ground to settle kind of.
Yeah, but that's. I mean, I think that's a problem generally with the whole culture of social media now. There's no grey areas. There's no margin for error, and you can't be someone investigating something and being curious and learning and considering your position. It's like pick a team and stick on it. Like, there's no... It's a bit like the Twitter pile-ons when people are, you know, getting absolutely cancelled for something that, you know, people jump in who've probably never even had an opinion on the matter before.
Yeah.
And I think it feeds from that same thing. It's kind of like you're either on the left side or the right side, the good guys or the bad guys, the right team or the wrong team. Mm. And there's no discussion. There's no... Same with people like arguing on Facebook and that. I see it all the time. People don't really come in to learn or to change their opinion.
Yeah,
they just come in to reinforce what they think.
Yeah, and then try and enforce that on others who are also closed to new opinion.
Yeah.
It's a vicious cycle.
It's literally, what's the Batman Joker reference thing? An unstoppable force and an immovable object. Two perfect opposites that won't ever change. Like, it feels like that. And yeah, but I agree. I mean, but then I do, as I was saying earlier, I don't necessarily think that just blocking friends who you don't agree with is the answer. But then there's also the thing of, like, you can just spend your entire life bickering on Facebook, and it's like, why the fuck would you want to spend your time doing that either?
Yeah, you're just sort of wasting your time and energy on one person instead of influencing more people and not on Facebook.
Well, or just also arguing with people that don't want to learn. Like, is it even worth doing in the first place? Like, you could just be off educating yourself or using the time for recreation, and instead you're arguing for 3 hours on Facebook with someone that literally isn't going to change their opinion ever. And really, the only person that wins is the platform. It's just pennies in Zuckerberg's pocket and more behavioral data for Google to target you with some ads and, you know.
And further reinforce your opinions.
Yeah, and and probably further convince you that whoever you're talking to is an idiot who doesn't know anything, and you were definitely right the whole time.
Yeah.
So, and then that gets reflected back to you via an algorithm, because Facebook pushes whatever's popping towards you. So, I don't know. I don't really go on Facebook anymore other than to post stuff for the label. I don't engage with it. I just post what we need to post as a platform. That's probably why we've got no reach.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not doing any help on that either. I don't really.
You know, you've been no help.
I mean, I feel the same about Twitter and Instagram. So I just don't bother.
So here's a question for you. It's a slightly expansive one, but it doesn't. Again, more a discussion point. Doesn't need a definitive answer. Do you think there'll be a point again where we can actually operate a label? Because as you know, my two dreams for this label, other than making a living off it, are to take all of our music off major streaming services and not have to use social media. Do you think there's a point in the future where we will never have to use social media and would be able to run a label without any socials? Because I can't think of a label that do it.
So there's a label that does it called Salter Selects. And I think it makes money, but it rides off the back of Dennis Salter's name.
Is he the bloke who wrote the Kama Sutra?
No, he's the one who threw bottles of Jägermeister into a crowd.
Oh, the guy we filmed at Snowbombing.
Yes.
That icon. Mate, that was one of the funniest things. So for those listening at home, Dennis Salter was playing at Snowbombing. It was actually, he's genuinely a brilliant DJ. He's so enthusiastic and so
phenomenal. It's your light Salter Selects as well. It's all disco.
Oh, right. I don't know how I've not heard it, to be fair. But Dennis Salter was dinging little mini bottles of Jägermeister into the crowd. And as far as I'm aware, I didn't see it connect. But I did see the aftermath. Someone got hit in the face with one and just blood went all over the snow. And it was just the guy who got hit didn't give a fuck. He was just having the best time. Couldn't give a shit. Obviously, blood on snow looks a bit more violent than normal. It made it sort of really step. But it was just, it was a moment of sheer joy. It was like joyously throwing Jägermeister. Guy got hit in the face, joyously carried on, didn't give a fuck. It was just a wonderful festival moment. And sadly, we didn't have any cameramen looking that way as it happened. But it was bloody brilliant. So he doesn't have any socials.
He has his own socials and he uses that, but not necessarily to promote the label, I don't think.
Right. But they still got them though. They're still, he can still.
Yeah, I mean, but he's got his own one and he promotes his own music on it, but he didn't really promote anything from the label apart from, like, you know, if it gets, when it's out, he might just be like, yeah, this is out on Salter Selects.
That's good of him.
But that's literally it. But everything will sell out, though.
Although in saying that, how did people do it before?
Well, people used to buy music before. People used to go to stores and download it.
Now that doesn't happen.
And also Facebook and Twitter and Instagram all didn't exist before. And when they did start and exist, only losers used it because it was crap. Everyone else was on Bebo because that was cool.
Everyone else was flogging their wares on Habbo Hotel. Bebo!
Everyone else was being mad racist on Habbo Hotel.
So pre-socials, because I wasn't paying attention pre-social media to how the music industry functioned. Was it taking out ads in magazines and journalists cover? I mean, I suppose there was a lot more platforms to get your music reviewed on and stuff, and there were blogs coming out of every fucking orifice.
Yeah, but I mean, even in the pop world, it was like people had money to do TV adverts for singles. Like, you get all your songs on compilations.
I remember when I first started at AEI, like the first commercial I directed for AEI went out on Sky Sports. And it went out on the ad break of Game of Thrones, and that was for like a CD compilation, but that was only 2012, 2013 time maybe.
Mm.
But even then, like now, you'd never advertise that on TV, really.
That the compilations, would... the compilation market. That point when we were AI, that was like the bit where it was completely turning for compilations. So that 2012, 2013, 2014 period. You try getting one out now, it's like, unless there's like something genuinely like packed full of exclusives, then there's no point doing one. It's not going to happen.
Yeah, I guess just being able to, the proliferation of playlists on streaming is just cut, like you can make your own compilation for free.
Yeah, exactly.
And it's exactly what you want. It's not got those 14 crud remixes tacked on the end or those tracks you got for 50 quid off your mates.
I mean, labels no longer, well, I mean, they still do have compilation people, but a lot of them are sort of navigated into a new role, which is just playlist curators.
So for brands and for like actual platforms, direct streaming services directly, or
so it'll be like their own record labels. It'll be so, like, for instance, Ministry of Sound have their own playlist curators now on playlists that are available, and they're like favored playlists for Apple Music. So Apple promote Ministry of Sound playlists.
Right. Can we not get our playlist promoted this way? Because I've done a Well Good Southern Hip Hop one, a Footwork one. We've got the Come Down collection, all the tunes for when you're having a horrible come down and wish you were dead and you've got loads of sad music. I've done like about 10 hours of that.
Yeah, I need more followers.
Oh, God. God, can we not just get paid without followers?
I mean, no. And like, that's genuinely old school because like, you will never sell a record without any fans.
We've got loads of fans. What are you on about?
You got no fans.
You got no fans. I mean, yeah, right. I suppose. So, but I guess the problem is, I understand. I think, well, I mean, I think I know the answer, but we'll put it on the air for the listeners. Surely the value of a playlist is far less than a compilation. So is anyone getting paid to curate these playlists or what?
They're getting paid to do it.
But surely they can't get paid as much as when we were doing CD comps and there was actually like legwork to do. And because negotiating a compilation with a group of labels, you've got to speak to the label, agree a price, get the tracks, all that. With a playlist, you just add them or you don't.
Yeah.
Like, so where are the man hours coming in? Who's doing a 40-hour week on playlists?
So the positives out of it are that instead of having your rights completely shafted by the compilation and, you know, just sort of, so instead of like, you know, you'll get 15% of what you'd normally make for 80% on your track, you're now getting that 48% because people are just playing your original song. Mm. So that's good. The downside is that who's going to be playing it?
80% worth nothing anymore?
Well, I mean, that's one of the downsides. The other downside is like, a playlist that's owned by Warner probably aren't going to add you into their playlist because you're not signed to Warner.
Mm.
So you end up being on a smaller playlist, so you have to work your way up all these other third-party playlists to get in there. Playlist world, mate. It's all crap. I don't know how I feel about it.
We really picked the right time to start a record label.
Well, you know how it goes, mate. Anyway, there's... Did you know that there is a new, speaking of losing Facebook friends, did you know that there's a new Riff Raff single out?
No. I have one with E40.
No, not that one. I mean, that one's...
Did you know there's a new E40 EP out?
No, probably. I mean, there's always a new E40 EP.
There's a new one since the last time I told you there's a new one out 45 minutes ago. It's got the best sugar-free verse on it ever. I think we should dig that out later.
I didn't know that, no.
It's actually very good. It's called The Curb Commentator Volume 1.
Okay. Well, I mean, I would say let's put it on, but there's a Riff Raff playlist that has one follower. Okay. So I'm going to play the song from that.
Is the one follower us?
I don't know. I'm hoping this is the right song.
Did you follow Riff Raff when you were really pissed last week?
Is this the song? It is the song, right.
Let's go.
I just hop out the lamp.
You doing
damn,
right.
Damn, 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 damn.
Oh my God,
Bonnie. Yeah, damn. I just hop out the lamp. Damn,
I just hop out the lamb. Damn. I just hop out the damn. I just hop out the damn. I just hop out the lamb. Damn. I just hop out the lamb. Damn. I just hop out the damn. I just hop out the damn. I just hop out the lamb. Damn. I just hop out the lamb. Damn. I just hop out the lamb. Damn. I just hop out the damn. I just hop out the lamb. Damn. I just hop out the lamb. Damn. I just hop out the yo, I just hop up the damn. I just ice on my couch, damn. I spit a pint in my mouth. Moving flex on my pirate ship, now nah, wait. I just ice on my lighthouse. Who him? It's the butterscotch boss. Whole body covered in gold, wait. Whole body covered in frost, damn. It's the white Rick Ross. Riding around in the Phantom. Eating shrimp pad thai in a Lambo. I'ma just cop me a dirt bike. I'ma just sip me a dirty Sprite. Whole house made out of glass. I'ma just move out to Germany. Lay back and smoke on a loud pack. I jump off a hurdle for rest. Yeah. I just hop up the lamb. Damn. I just hop up the lamb. Damn. I just hop up the damn. I just hop up the damn. I just hop up the lamb. Damn. I just hop up the lamb. Damn. I just hop up the damn. I just hop up the damn. I just hop up the lamb. Damn. I just hop up the lamb. Damn. I just hop up the lamb. Damn. I just hop up the damn. I just hop up the lamb. I just hop out the lamb, damn. I just hop out the I just hop out the
yo, fell asleep on a brick, hit a lick, highway 6. I can sip on a surfy sun kid. I can pull up in sun trust, tangerine sunset on a tour bus. Yeah, Burberry vest, rap game, Johnny Quest. Step on your neck like a T-Rex. Hey, on when I flex. I got a Vamoose, you amateurs. I slide in a banister. I left my pajamas in Canada. I hop up the beef. I jump in some Wagyu. Desert Eagle riding around with the troops. Cognac diamonds on my tooth. The roof of my mouth is selfie. Hermes on my belt clip. I sold a bird to an elf. 100 blood, so I smoke by myself. 1942, I only drink top shelf. Shot more jumpers than Tony Dell. I walk through the fall leaves. What's such palm trees? Rip.
Riff Raff with Hop Out the Lamb.
So I love Riff Raff, as you well, we both do, as you know. Do you remember when you bought us tickets to see Riff Raff for the staff Christmas party?
It was some shit like student band from
it was some shit
from
indie band
Mayan
playing in a clothes shop in Hackney. And I thought we got tickets to Riff Raff for £8 each.
It seemed too good to be true. And it was weird he was playing Paper Dress Vintage. But
now you mention it, that does strike me as odd.
Well, then everything about Riff Raff is odd. Like, he's got a song called Hop Out the Lamb off the new album Vanilla Gorilla.
Has he got another album out?
It's coming out soon.
Oh, I see.
It'll be out in a month, I think.
When did Cranberry Vampire came out at Christmas, didn't it? Because we put that on the Christmas special.
Yeah, it was a little bit earlier, but it was around that time.
Well, we were playing at the Christmas party pretty much constantly.
I think it was like start of December.
Yeah, but we were banging it at the Christmas party more or less all weekend, weren't we? I mean, I really like the line on that one, jump out the hop out the lamp. All in all, that was shit. That was really lazy and boring. But it did have the line, I slide down the banister, I left my pyjamas in Canada. Which I got time, that's like textbook, that's the riffraff we need.
But no matter how bad a song may be from him, he'll always have a great line like that, or, you know, the time to pickpocket on a left.
Absolute treat.
The guy cannot be stopped.
I mean, he's got some absolute treats up his sleeve. That's not one of them. If that's the lead single off the album.
Yeah, but that doesn't mean anything anymore, lead singles off of an album. It's just a track that you're going to put out before you put another track out.
Yeah, but you try and put out the one that's going to attract people to listen to the rest of the record. Like
normally, it's the second track or the track that you push when the album is out is the big one now. So the next single might be the big one.
Well, I hope so, because that wasn't even the medium one.
Mm.
That was fucking toilet.
That was filler. But
that was filler. That's exactly what that was. That's like one of those, we just need to get it over the 30-minute mark or it'll be an EP track.
But he did have a line that said, I slid down the banister, I left my pyjamas in Canada. And that cannot be
I would have just repeated that the amount of times he repeated, then I hop out the lamb. I would have just had that line true. About Bannister and Canada.
True.
Ad infinitum. That would have been a much better... But yeah, fuck that. What's next, mate? I can't even remember how we got to Riff Raff there. That was impressive. We totally wandered off.
Yeah, we were on a proper disappearing act there.
That was good. I liked it. What else have you been thinking about this week? Oh, well, that was unfriending on Facebook, wasn't it? That was the...
Yeah, but fuck that. I've left my friends off of... I don't even...
Coming undone.
Hello. Very saucy.
What are the rules on Free and the Nip on YouTube?
What?
I said, free what nipples? Rules on, I don't want to get me tits out on...
Oh, male is fine, female is not fine.
Classic combo.
I'm not sure if they have rules on trans yet, but yeah, as far as genders go, yeah, it's they believe in two, I believe, and that's questionable. Something that they have to address at some point. So what's got my goat is well, it's not got my goat. It's a day of rejoice, a day of. Well, I say rejoice. I'm really upset now. I've just seen the score. But it's the return of football. English football has returned to the country once again. I know I'm a bit pissed off too because Arsenal are losing 2-0 to Man City at the moment.
So how is this working? It's Manchester Athletic and Arsenal United.
Yeah, close enough. And they're currently playing in Manchester behind closed doors, I guess. There's no fans in the stadium. So they're just playing to an empty stadium, an empty 80,000-seater stadium.
What's the atmosphere saying?
Fucking lively, mate. It's about as dead as one of our club nights, mate.
We haven't done one yet.
You know how it's going to go.
I mean, yeah, that's true. I mean, I don't know why a club night where we book everyone and force them to play Riff Raff all night is going to do well, but we're still going to do it.
Yeah, but I think it's good news. It's going to be 6 weeks of footy. They're going to just be stockpiling it on itself for a long time until the season is done.
So how long is the normal Premier League? How long is a normal season?
So a normal season will run from August to May. And so far what has been played of the season was August to March.
Right.
Or August to late February, start of March.
So what are they doing now? Are they playing the games that were missed throughout March, April?
Yeah. Yeah. And then also playing the games that need to be played for April or May.
Right. And then what, they're going to have a just roll straight into the next season or...?
Well, that's what I don't really know. I think they're going to have a bit of a delay. Yeah, they're going to have a bit of a delay because otherwise everyone will just be knackered. I mean, I know they've just had their two-month, three-month break already, but it's like, even still, it's going to be absolutely shitted because they're playing like... The amount of games that are just being plugged on top of each other is insane. It's like Arsenal playing three times this week.
Oh, right, so they're literally just like, whenever there's a spare 90 minutes, it's like, go and play them.
Pretty much. It's like there's a game on pretty much every day.
I mean...
Which for a spectator should be good, but you just know that by the end of it all, everyone's just going to be really shit at football. Everyone's going to be completely knackered and half-past dead.
Ooh. See, I'd rather watch half-past dead.
I mean, looking at the score at the moment, me too. 2-0 down with a red card. Bloody awful.
I'm not a footballing advocate, really. But I have been surprised at how much, like some of, like my brother and a few of my other friends have, I've been surprised at how much people have, it's made a huge, like, I thought the same though, like the amount of people I know missing the rave. And it's like, yeah, I miss being able to go raving, but like, really, we just used to get pissed and go home and watch films anyway. Like,
yeah.
I found that I haven't missed anything. Like, I miss the pub a bit, but it's like, wake up pining. It's fine. I miss it, but, like, I can get on with other shit. It's not my day. It's not my life. And
I think after work, I'm pining for a pub, especially on a Friday. or a Thursday or a Wednesday, maybe a Tuesday or Monday.
Yeah, Monday to Friday is the day that I find I miss it the most.
Yeah.
And then Saturday and Sunday quite a lot. But no, I mean, I always understood football was a big thing for a lot of people. But like one of my friends said, he's like, without football to anchor his weekend, his kind of weekly routine just doesn't really have any ballast. And I thought it was quite interesting. I find it really dull. I really don't enjoy watching it.
But then, like, imagine if you didn't have films to, you know, chill your weekend.
Yeah, but you've, like, is there anyone that just watches football and doesn't do anything else? Like, I have a range of hobbies, and some have been...
Oh, yeah, no, I mean, there are some dolls that only watch football, but of course, like, there are people who have a range of hobbies too, but it is, like, one of those things that you can just, if your brain has been operating for too long and now you just want to just watch a bunch of people just kick a ball about in a really good way, then there is just something really calming about it, at least I think anyway. Like, I'm not one of those people that gets absolutely fucking mad about their team winning or losing. It's like, I support Arsenal, I'm used to losing now. It was really nice when we won that time, but those years have gone.
The salad years are over. I just think it's just boring. I don't know, it just seems to be a way for...
But you're not that into sport apart from American football, and I don't really get why. Because no, isn't that like...
I don't know. I'm not massively into American football. Like, I used to watch it a lot, but I think that coincided with doing a lot of drugs. Because when you're just like tripping your balls off, 6 hours on the sofa, just chain drinking with really colourful, noisy shit on in the background just kind of works.
Yeah, that makes sense. Because, I mean, it is basically just adverts every second. And
The game's insanely long. Like,
yeah.
The thing is, they're 15-minute quarters, but I've never seen, like, a game can range from 3 hours to 8 hours. Excuse me. Panic! Coronavirus. Sorry.
Coronavirus!
Panic! Sneezed. It's all right. I covered my face. Don't worry about it. It's fine. I'm shielding.
Covered my face and wiped on a pensioner.
Yeah, it's fine. It's all right. I covered my face and then I headbutted a pensioner. American football, I still quite like it, but I think it's like the sport is not the point. I think that's why I like that. The sport is almost the least relevant bit. The show around it is what you watch, and I like watching the nutters in the crowd and all the strange culture of it.
I get that.
It's a bit like WWF. I have no respect for the athleticism. I couldn't care less.
Yeah.
Like all these people going, well, they're athletes. I don't give a shit. Like, it's just...
WWF is a predetermined entertainment show, but like, I feel the same way about the cricket.
Cricket, yeah, so cricket as well. I think cricket's really boring, but I'd love to go to the cricket for a day with you.
Yeah.
And just have a day on the smash at the cricket, which I still think we need to do.
I think we do, because I could be entertained by the actual cricket for about 10 minutes.
Yeah, we'll be 10 minutes and then...
Then I'll have an hour off to like just get absolutely smashed with a Barmy army, and then I'll be back by watching the game for 10 minutes. And I realise that cricket's shit.
I mean, I shit you not. My greatest ever sporting experience was when me, you, and Springbet went to the Leighton Orient game for the Christmas party.
We turned up at halftime.
I know.
We turned up at halftime, bollocks. Shout out to my mate Snuggles. He He helped us get in 45 minutes into a game. I'm pretty sure he got told off about it too.
Yeah, and probably.
And then
we got done for trying to take our drinks out onto the terrace.
But that game was fucking brilliant. Like, it was like there were like 6 goals. It, like, we turned up and it was like 0-0.
I loved the sort of the performance around the game. Like, when we got out, obviously, part of Leighton Orient Stadium has been sold off to property developers.
Oh, yeah.
So there's flats built into the stadium, which amused me in itself. But as soon as those, like, new money people came out on their little balcony for the game, all the season ticket holders just booed the fuck out of them and threw empty cups at them. And it was just, I mean, I do. The thing is, I get the culture of sport and I love spectating on the spectators and the sport, but I think the sports, the actual game is the dullest bit. Like, football, you've got all these absolute icons like Ray Parler kicking about, but the last thing I want to do is watch them kick a ball.
Yeah, you like to go on the piss with Teddy Sheringham, but not watch him play.
You'd like to go on the piss with Ryan Giggs, but not leave him with your wife. But so is today the first day of the return of the football then?
Yes, it is.
Today is the 17th of June, we're recording.
That's true, yes, 17th of June. Arsenal are still 2-0 down to Manchester City. Raheem Sterling and Kevin De Bruyne have both scored, and David Luiz has been sent off for the Arsenal. So we are going to lose.
So that's 11 to 10, is it?
Yes.
What did he get sent off for? Something iconic or just rubbish like pulling a shirt?
I don't know. It's a straight red, so he must have just kicked shit out of someone, but...
He didn't go Cantona and like bicycle kick over the boards or anything.
No, but I'm kind of in Cantona's favour on that. I think he's a bit of a G for doing that. I'm on his side.
I mean, yeah, I'm team Cantona pretty much whatever.
Yeah, true.
My favourite who's your favourite footballer of all time, Ashley?
It's always going to be an Arsenal player. It has to be. Of recent days, it's been Ray Parler.
Oh,
before that, it was either Ian Wright, because he is just one of the best and bound and just full of energy and just a great footballer and a hilarious person. It's either him or someone who would be more fitting in an IT company, like an IT tech support team. He's an Arsenal player who was their right back. His name's Nigel Winterburn. And I don't think I know him. He looks exactly like a Nigel Winterburn.
he looks like the guy that can install your VPN.
Yeah. He looks exactly like that. So imagine that, but like just in a full Arsenal kit.
But so I don't know. I mean,
who's your favourite?
Who's my favourite footballer? There's two obvious options.
Ray Parler.
Option one is Hinatoshi Nakata.
Cool.
Because in joke, I don't even know what he looks like. It's just it's just a running joke basically between my brother and I since we were very young. Or Stan Collymore.
What a great actor.
Because he starred in Basic Instinct 2. I've never seen him play football. Full disclosure. See how I did that?
Very good. Very good.
Corporate sleaze references coming out of all orifices.
Very good. Just like in a corporate sleaze film.
So, yeah, it's probably one of those two. Wait, did Stan Collymore rape someone?
Oh, yeah, you can't like him.
Yeah, no, I don't. Yeah. Him and Tisha Nakata. Let's play it safe.
I thought he did that, and I think he headbutted Eureka Johnson as well.
Jesus.
Intimidating.
He's got a fucking big head.
Yeah. Do you know what Dion Dublin?
It's like getting headbutted by one of the Easter Island statues. That's like, that'll put you in a coma. That's intensive care level headbutting.
I thought Dion Dublin would have been one of your favourites.
Yeah, no, obviously inventor of the Doob Dion Dublin is. I see him more
presenter
as a
of
property
homes,
mogul.
Presenter of homes under the hammer. Yeah.
He's more property mogul, genius, inventor, billionaire, philanthropist than footballer.
No, that's Robbie Fowler.
Oh, God. Do you remember when we were going to go to one of his property seminars? Then we found out he doesn't turn up to his own property seminars, so we thought, fuck it, we'll go pub. I think we ejected on that plan at the right time. I think that's one of the only times we made the right decision.
I think so. Mind you, that might have been the one time he turned up.
True. I mean, the one time I turned up to see Wiley play live in Yarmouth, Wiley turned up. Which might sum up Wiley. He didn't go Glastonbury, but he did turn up at Atlantis in Great Yarmouth.
Yeah, that's like London gigs he doesn't go to when he's in London.
Yeah, but he come down Great Yarmouth, mate. He's well up for a trip to the seaside, is Wiley.
don't get it. But, you know, fair enough, fair enough. But, yeah, that's what's been, well, it started off being a rejoice for me, the return of football, and now it's just pissed me right off.
I was going to say, would you rather they just didn't bother?
Yeah. Yeah. Wish they'd just end it now.
Ban the sick filth now.
Then Millwall will be playing soon.
Millwall. Shout out Craig.
Craig Evans, everyone's favourite Millwall fan. Great man.
I mean, he's the only person I know that supports Millwall, but
no, I know two of my old bosses used to support Millwall, hold tight, Tim and Rob, and also Jazzy B supports Millwall. Jazzy B's son plays for Millwall. Name's Romeo.
Ah, fair enough. I mean, I'm from the sticks. Everyone around here supports Ipswich or Norwich.
Hang on a minute. Doesn't Tamer Hassan support Millwall? I'm pretty sure
you even know that. And why do you know that?
I'm pretty sure Tamer Hassan supports Millwall. Or maybe he was just playing the Millwall fan in Green Street 2. Or 1.
Or 3.
Or 3. Green or was Street it Football 2, Factory? Mate,
Green Street 2 is... if you want a treat of a football film, this is the plot to Green Street 2. I shit you not. The Millwall have gone to prison after the events of Green Street 1. And they're opposite... On the block in the prison, they're opposite whoever the rival firm are in Green Street 1. I can't fucking remember.
The West Ham.
Probably. And the plot of Green Street...
It's called Green Street. It's a road... You're not from London, don't worry.
Yeah, I don't know what you're on about, mate. I shit you not. So the plot is they're in prison opposite each other like they're neighbours on a fucking street.
Hmm.
And for some unexplained reason that I can't remember because I was really drunk when I watched it at 6 a.m. around yours waiting for you to get up for radio. Basically, the prison warden turfs up and says, if you beat this lot of football... you can finish your sentence early. So it's like sort of, it's like Football Factory crossed with Cool Runnings. It's like a it's like a shitty motivational sports film crossed with loads of people going, have it, you can't. And I'm surprised Craig Fairbrass doesn't make an appearance.
It's not that big a surprise, is it?
I mean, he's made so many films at the minute, all of which of low quality. He was probably really busy. He's just made Rise of the Foot Soldier 4, Marbella.
Oh, I've been meaning to watch that. I've got it.
you fuck.
I've got it saved to watch.
Jesus, I'm this is what happens when the football's not on. You start watching Rise of the Foot Soldier 4 Marbella. Fuck me, mate, get the football back on.
I just need to like start you know, kicking people in that. I'm trying to find a song that's related to football for us to play.
I mean, Chumbawamba, Tub Thumping.
No, I don't want to do that. I'm almost certain I remember...
I know a good one. I know a genuinely good one.
I almost remember one by Skepta about football, but it's not.
What about
I don't want the one with Mick Jagger, because that's awful.
God, no. Why don't we get on Super Furry Animals, The Man Don't Give a Fuck, which is written about the mad legend player Robin Friday.
Okay.
Let's go for that, yeah. So Robin Friday was from... I think he played for like Cambridge or someone. He was like a Division 1 player. My brother was telling me about him. And he was like a mad drunk who used to like come on hammered at half time and he'd like toe punt the ball from the halfway line into the goal, then just sort of go back to the pub. And he was just one of these mercurial talents who wasted it all because he couldn't stop getting pissed. Very much in the ethos of the city.
Right, well. I'll put it on. You know, Craig's from Cambridge.
I might have made Cambridge up. Maybe I was thinking of Craig. Maybe the song's about Craig. He loves the Millwall.
Probably is. The man don't give a fuck.
I mean, he literally don't give a fuck. Well, he does give a fuck about music. He don't give a fuck about much else. Shout out Craig every time. I'm going to edit this bit out. When you're ready. I'm going to edit this bit too.
God. Is this good?
Yes, good tune.
Okay, I'm going to have to talk. Hopefully it starts by then.
Yeah, that'd be helpful. Right, so Ashley has teed up the track wrong, so we're just sat in silence. That was Super Furry Animals with The Man Don't Give a Fuck. You queued it up on the wrong computer, Ashley, so we sat in silence for about 10 minutes whilst you were having a piss.
Alright, good. Did we?
Thanks for saying I look like the...
They weren't playing out of mine. Oh, well.
But, yeah, so leading on from the football, actually... The other thing I've been burning to chat about this week, something that's been I've been thinking about, it's been consuming a lot of my time, is the a friend of mine, Boris, sent me a video for my birthday. Said, "Hope you're having fun. Hope you seeing your team."
Your friend Boris, you got friends in a lot of places, haven't you?
Yeah, I would imagine he's becoming less and less fond of his birth name as the days grind on.
Probably, yeah. What was once the jovial side enemy in GoldenEye is now the twat leading our country.
What was once the jovial side villain slash pervert of GoldenEye is now the jovial pervert leading our country. arguably the main villain. So anyway, my mate Bo sent me a video of credited on YouTube as England's first organised fight. And shout out Craig or Evans. It's the Millwall versus Brentford in an organised football fight. And we'll play a little bit of it for those watching on YouTube. If you're listening to the podcast, check out the YouTube if you want to see it. If you can't be asked, honestly, you're not missing out. But this has probably brought me the most joy this week. It's an amazing video. Let's check a bit of that out, and then we'll check back.
You're not playing the full 4 minutes, are you?
No, we're not. We ain't got that fucking long. Oh, I've also got Indian Flute by Timbaland and Magoo queued up. We could maybe do 8 minutes. That guy's just totally missed a punch. One guy's got actual fighting, but he's got like boxing, martial arts gloves and a weightlift. There might be weightlifting gloves. It's great when they all start to get a bit tired. They start to flag 2 minutes in, the stamina just ain't there. I've had too much carling.
Shouldn't have gone down spoons early.
Well, that's the problem. If you have the large mixed grill at 12 midday, you're asleep by 3 p.m. Yeah, good game, lads, good game. So, I was thinking about the first arranged fight in England. I'm not a historian. I'm not fully up to speed. But that was put on YouTube in 2018. I'm pretty sure Boudicca fought the Romans, which was an organised fight. I think that was pre-2018.
Yeah, but was that an organised fight, though? Or was it, like, a battle? Because they're different. Like, the Battle of Hastings is a battle.
But where's the demarcation point between a fight and a battle? Linguistically, I get because it's kind of like, when does a hill become a mountain? There's a very specific degree of incline where a hill is a mountain.
I mean, to be honest, I'd argue that this organised fight wasn't even a fight. It looked a bit more like, I don't know, like lager fueled capoeira.
There was a lot of spinning around and very little contact. There's actually a great comment in the comment section. Where is it now? Let's see. That's quite a good comment. I didn't know Millwall and Brentford had that many fans. Final score, Millwall 0, Brentford 0. But my favourite is Patrick Bonner. Shout out Patrick Bonner 1 year ago, 1.6 thousand likes. More people have landed on the moon than punches landed in that fight. Thought that was quite a good assessment of the first organised fight in England.
Sorry, I love that the umpire or the fight adjudicator, I don't really know what you call him, I love that he's kind of dressed like an extra from Human Traffic.
The umpire's there in a bright orange, I mean, it's probably a Helly Hansen jacket, isn't it?
Yeah.
And a nice bucket hat going. It's a bit where he goes to somebody, goes, leave him, go on, get him. He's had enough. He's all right.
Right. He used to be the floor manager at Gio Goy.
Either that or he's dropped £4.80 on the sales rack at TK Maxx. I just love it if, like, from now on, all adjudicators have to dress like extras from Human Traffic. So you're just, like, you're just in The Hague and there's a guy in a flower shirt with, like, ski goggles on going, leave him, he's had enough, cunts, leave him. That'd be brilliant. At the Nuremberg trials, there's just a guy with a disco whistle and a bucket hat, like, leave it, we've all had enough, bruv.
I'd love it if leave it out became a new objection.
Yeah, leave it out. Like in a... Is it Fit But You Know It by the Streets where the hook goes, leave it out? Are you smoking something? Leave it out. You can't have that behaviour in this establishment.
Yes, it's the break in that one, isn't it?
Yeah.
The mid-late, yeah.
Yeah, that'd be brilliant. Just in commons, you just got to stand up and go, leave it out, whenever you don't want to. Yeah, it's amazing. I love as well, like, even I get people like a bit of a ruck and that, but those people can't even, they can barely move, they're so unfit. Like there's points where people sort of walk towards someone and then stop to take a breath.
And that's like, it's just, but it is genuinely organised. They're like, they've gone proper shirts and skins.
Yeah, yeah, they are doing it like five-side rules.
No matter how pissed up you are, you'll know, like, if you're twatting a topless bloke, they're probably Brentford.
If you find yourself hammered, drunk and shirtless, you've probably got embroiled in a Brentford scuffle. you've somehow been signed up.
A Brentford scuffle.
Imagine if that was national service. You either have to go and join Brentford or Millwall for a year. we're not sending you to the army. It's become too politically difficult. So you've got to go spend a year on the Millwall terraces.
So I've not seen that many teams play football beyond Arsenal and Leyton Orient. But two teams that I have actually been to their stadiums and watched them play in are Millwall and Brentford.
Why? How is this?
Well, it's like I've lived in New Cross and that's the nearest team. So I went down for a match and it was good-ish.
Wait, who's the nearest team to New Cross? Millwall?
Millwall.
Right.
It's like a 10-minute walk from the house.
My London geography there shining through.
Good work. Then my dad has lived in like far west London for like a long, long time. And his nearest team are Hayes. I've been to see them as well.
No, not that bad.
Hayes. Hayes United.
Where the fuck is Hayes? I've never even heard of Hayes.
It's like before Slough.
Oh, well,
there you go.
Oh, yeah. No wonder I haven't heard of it.
Another team in that area is Brentford, and we went to see a Brentford game, and it was the most boring game ever. And then we left at half time.
Did they all play with their shirts off?
Probably. I didn't notice.
Were the goalposts two jumpers?
I know. I didn't get twatted.
Yeah. Did a man with a bucket hat shout, "Leave it out! Leave it out!" when you walked in the arena?
That's one thing that almost definitely happened.
When you walked in the arena. Sorry, yeah, because Brentford have got an arena. I'm at the Brentford Coliseum watching the boys play Millwall.
They've barely got a stadium.
Have they sold half off to a property developer as well?
You know what? I have a feeling that, because I think they're moving stadium, and I have a feeling that they're actually doing that.
Icons.
I think it's great.
Oh, yeah, I've got time for it. I actually think that adds to the air of the stadium.
It does. Like, my favourite Orient chant is, "We pay for your flats, we pay for your flats, we paid our council tax, we pay for your flats."
Man, football chants are an art in themselves. I've got so much time for... I love the speed at which they get deployed as well. Like, after there's a big event. I can't remember one of the best ones of those I've ever heard. I can't remember what team it is, but it was the team, you know, the cabbie that went mad. Was it Raoul Moat, the cabbie who went on a rampage?
In Newcastle.
Yeah, was it?
Well, he was in Newcastle, yeah.
Yeah, so I think it must have been then. So they played the team. Do you remember Derek Bird?
Rings a bell.
So Derek Bird was another guy who went a bit mad and tried, like, went on a bit of a spree. Shot like someone, or it might not have even been shot, but he was like, basically, he was good's maybe not the term. He was a less rampagey Raoul Moat.
Right.
When Raoul Moat's team played wherever this guy was from, they'd obviously cottoned on the parallels between these two people. And someone in the crowd started to chant, "Who the fuck is Derek Bird? Who the fuck is Derek Bird?" And it was just like, to have picked up the parallel and then thought, I know, football chant. That's what we're going to do here.
Just genius.
Absolutely loved it. Yeah, one of my faves.
It's like, it's just, it's really kind of to the bone folk singing.
Well, it's as close, and it's as close to folk singing as you can get, isn't it, really? And you've got the choral element of everyone. There's a definite power to it, I think, when done correctly.
It's like a more menacing part of it's a more menacing version of The Landlord's Daughter from The Wicker Man.
More menacing?
I don't know, actually.
Now, all of them leave me slightly uncomfortable and with the feeling that something terrible is about to happen to me at the hands of a massive angry mob. So, I don't know. What's Baxter's team? Is it Bournemouth whose chant is, we've got inflatables?
Yes, it is.
They're a seaside town. I love that your chant's not even about football. You can't even big up your football skills. You've got to big up your tourism industry instead.
I think I can't remember which team they were playing, but there was a famous moment when Darren Bent was playing for Liverpool and he took a shot and it hit a beach ball and then just like skidded off. Like it missed the target because it hit this beach.
The beach ball was on the pitch?
Yeah, the beach ball was on the pitch. Some fan just lobbed the beach ball on. And then I think whatever team they were playing started, like in the next match that they played each other, started doing that chant.
We've got inflatables, Jack.
Yeah.
That's brilliant. See, I think for me, that's what football's missing, that American football and wrestling don't miss as much. If in the middle of trying to play football, someone just launched 50 inflatables onto the pitch, or like some 8-foot man came out dressed as a fox and started drop kicking people, like Foxy Bingo Man ran out and started 2-footed tackling people, I'd be all over that. But it's too organized and too serious. There's too much money involved.
What, American football, you mean?
No, normal football.
Oh, that's still got... I mean, you still got that about.
I mean, yeah, I've watched Britain's first organised fight, mate.
There you go. That's not what you're complaining about.
Nothing sums up football quite like England's first organised fight.
Former mate Snuggles, I mentioned him earlier. He's a massive football fan. And he now supports Tottenham like a fucking Egypt. So he started supporting Man United when he was a kid, and by my rules of life, you can't change your team beyond the age of 8. But he did. Anyway.
Yeah, but then I would argue, as a kid, everyone just supported Man U because they won everything, and at the time you had to have a Beckham shirt.
Yeah, but at the age of 8, you decided then.
I think it's more genuine to realise after 8 you only support them because everyone else did, and then pick a team you actually like.
Yeah, but then he changed his team at the age of like 18 or 20 or something.
All right, no, yeah, he's
long committed. No, he's just a snake in the grass. But anyway, for the scumbag stag do, because I was the best man. Me and Torian were best men because he couldn't decide to, because he's a Spurs fan and can't decide on anything. We decided to take him to a football game and treat him to a game at Aston Villa, and he spent his entire stag in the city of Aston.
Didn't Dion Dublin play for Aston Villa?
Yes.
Football knowledge. See that? That's my bloody.
In the game, I got Snuggles to have a pitch with the Aston Villa mascot, a lion.
Oh, so they do have mascots.
That's a picture of Snuggles, like, dressed up in, like, a weird kind of... You know, like those... Yeah. Yeah, they do.
I swear Norwich doesn't have a canary.
It probably won't be a canary. It'll be something, though.
No, their logo's a canary, isn't it?
Yeah, but then, I mean, Watford are, like, the ultimate anomaly. They're, like, their... So, like, their badge on their kit is of... Right, so have you heard of an animal called a hart?
No.
It's like a glorified deer stroke moose.
Oh, yeah, like the white hart.
Yeah.
Yeah. I know via pubs.
Okay. So that is like on their badge. And it's because Watford are in the borough or in the town of Hertfordshire, or the borough or the city of Hertfordshire, the county of Hertfordshire.
But then. That was like a reverse Russian doll. You just kept going one scale up until you got there.
The country of Hertfordshire.
The universe of Hertfordshire.
But But then their nickname are the Hornets, and their mascot is a hornet.
I mean, that doesn't make any sense.
I know, right? It's because they wear yellow and black.
I mean, that all makes more sense. Why don't they just change the fucking logo?
I know, that's what I mean.
The entire setup, except their logo's a deer.
There was even a competition to change the logo, and like some great submissions came in.
And the deer won it.
Well, no, the deer just stuck. It just stuck. Like they didn't. People just decided they didn't want to change it from the fucking heart. I know this because Dom, who you know, is a Watford fan, a diehard Watford fan.
Jesus, man, the staff of Believe really like some niche football teams. Like you're probably like you're as close to the mainstream as they're getting.
I mean, I probably am, but I mean, then again, I do have a big soft spot for Leighton Orient.
I mean, obviously, the Orient are the best. Why are they called? So actually, possibly back to Appropriation Beats. I don't know why are they called Leighton Orient.
So I've never really known this.
Well, that's the end of that episode. Thanks for.
I'll try and find out. Talk amongst yourself.
Should we bang a tune on and research Leighton Orient?
No, but they used to be based in Hackney, and they were called Clacton something.
They were in Hackney and called Clacton or
Clacton.
Oh right, okay, that makes more sense.
Yeah, but I mean, the origins of Leighton Orient does fall for me. I don't really know. We can bang a tune on in the meantime. I can look it up.
We could put on the Oriental by Status Quo. It's one of the least appropriate tracks ever written. Do you want to go for that?
Yeah, it's already on.
I mean, we could get the show cancelled just for playing this. But,
should we do it? Should we not do it?
No. I think the people should hear it because it's just
for historical purposes, and this might be why Leighton Orient are called Leighton Orient.
I mean, if you hear this, you'll know. But I'll tee it up. We'll see.
I've already teed it up. It's already on.
Are you on? You. It's got the rhyming scheme of a 4-year-old. He also rhymes Lexus with Texas. Who's done
her
that?
Her name was Mia. From North Korea.
Pitbull rhymes Kodak with Kodak.
Bring your Land Rover. She said that suits me. I take a shower on every hour. Oh, the Oriental are very, very special. If you ever get some, you want another one and another one. The Oriental are very, very gentle. I got one for a cousin. Can't send me a dozen. Her name was Mei Wong. She came from Hong Kong. She was a raver of Eastern flavor. I said I love you. She said I'd love to go down to Texas. Must have one Lexus. Oh, the Oriental is a very, very special. If you ever get some, you want another one.
I'm going to fade that out there because I feel sick.
Yeah, I think that's probably for the best. It's a bit worrying.
I mean, yeah, maybe we'll have to lyric genius that later. But
but in the meantime, I have found out why Leighton Orient are called Leighton Orient. So
go for it.
You know, so it's contentious, actually. So Wikipedia says it's called so because of the Second World War, and it just leaves it as that.
Okay, good.
Think is weird, but then
does that really clear anything up?
No, not at all. But then the answerbank.co.uk says that it's called so because of the Orient shipping line and that East London was a direct route on the Orient right. shipping.
That makes more sense than because of World War II.
But then at the time that they're saying that was a thing, Leighton Orient were in Clapton. Oh, wait. Oh, no. In 1898, they became Clapton Orient. Okay. Fine. I'm on board. No. I don't have to.
So they've
been
playing since the 1800s.
I mean, most teams have.
I mean, yeah, I don't know why I'm surprised. I know nothing about football, so I just assumed the kind of branding started later, but...
No, football's old as fuck, mate.
Yeah, it is. Oh, well. I mean, that is probably better than Status Quo's Track the Oriental, which...
Probably.
I mean, that... I think that Status Quo track came out in, like, the early 2000s.
Yeah, 2002, it says.
It was already at a point where that shouldn't be happening.
Mm. Oh well.
Yeah. Right.
I've got one thing to end on.
Oh yeah, there was.
It's a troubling time, and I think this is the most disgusting thing of all the things that we've talked about on the show.
And we've covered some quite heavy stuff over the.
And it gets worse here. So my last gripe. So like working in music, we find out that TikTok is the most important platform to use nowadays. And sort of trying to find what your songs are on TikTok.
That's not the truth, is it?
For like pop music stuff that's charting, yeah, it is. Oh, I know, right? Anyway, and a big thing that is appearing on TikTok at the moment and on other platforms too, Instagram, YouTube, whatever, are people that are, and they're taking it deadly seriously, is using micro scooters to do extreme sports tricks. So it's like, imagine being. Now I think Tony Hawk is a twat anyway.
Yeah. But, I mean, I love the games, but he's a 60-year-old man who's dressed like he's just fallen out of an Avril Lavigne video, and he needs to take a bath.
I mean, he's. I mean, I think doing these tricks on a bicycle is pretty cool. So Matt Hoffman, I'm down with. I think he's all right. Doing it on a snowboard's okay. Sean White's fine with me. But who the fuck is going to buy a game that's promoted as a micro scooter stunt game?
Is there one? Is there?
I don't know, but do
I
you
mean,
think
I assume that there is? Happen? Yeah, what was the yeah, that franchise of so and so's pro something.
Yeah.
There'll be like, I don't know, Lindsay McPhee's pro micro scooter. Just some fucking 8-year-old girl on a scooter doing a school run. Like,
I mean,
that, to be honest, I've made that sound better.
I'll be more down with that because I remember. Do you remember the game Paperboy?
Yeah, when you had to deliver papers.
Well, good man. Genuinely, like the best thing that ever happened to the Game Boy or Commodore 64 or whatever it was on originally.
I played it on the original Nintendo on the NES.
Yeah. But, I remember having it on a Game Boy and I think I had it on a Commodore 64.
You had a Commodore 64?
No, right?
That was about 10 years old when you were born.
Mate, I didn't grow up rich.
No, I know, but I didn't even know you could get them at that point. It wasn't a...
Yeah, no, I had all the cassettes.
It wasn't an assault on your class status. It was just, I'm just impressed one was still working.
Mate, I had all the games, man. Remember James Pond?
James Pond, yeah, I never quite understood the appeal.
Oh, am I frozen?
You're frozen. Just say that, just go through those games again.
Yeah, sorry, I had Buggy Boy, James Pond. There was enough with like Ghosts, Ghouls, and was it called Ghouls and Ghosts? I know
Ghouls
that was a
Ghosts,
game.
Yeah, that was a definite game.
No, that was a game.
Michael Jackson's Moonwalker. That was a Commodore 64 classic.
Oh, don't think I had that one.
Yeah, I think I seem to remember that was an actual game.
I think I only exclusively played Buggy Boy and.
What's Buggy Boy? I don't think I know Buggy Boy.
It's like Gran Turismo, but better.
Ooh. Like Gran Turismo, but you don't actually have to worry about how aerodynamic your car is or pay to get the wheel nuts fixed on your brake. Like,
it's like Gran Turismo without four-sprung birch technique.
I'm fascinated, actually, and this filters into Paperboy in a way. I'm fascinated by games that essentially simulate real life. Like, do you remember the board game, The Game of Life?
Yeah.
Where the aim of the game was to get a house and pay your taxes.
Yeah, it was similar to Payday.
Yes. That's another one. Payday. And on a lesser level, Monopoly, but it's like, and The Sims to a degree, it's like a video game where you go down the job center and fill in your form and collect your 48 quid and then walk home because you can't afford the bus. Who wants to play that game?
Yeah, it's like, it gets too insular in itself for a lot of these new games. It's like, I want to play a shoot 'em up, but I don't want to actually be in a war. I don't want to experience trench foot.
Yeah. I quite like shooting people and stuff, but I don't actually want to have to go to Iraq and assassinate people and get PTSD.
Exactly. It's why Grand Theft Auto has done well, but then I don't know, because then it doesn't explain why Call of Duty has done well, because that is one of those games where you get trench foot and you pass out or whatever.
But I think those Call of Duty games, I think there's a slightly darker element. I think a lot of the, like, at the moment, like, you can see it with these, you know, the Democratic People's Republic of Football Defense lads who are out fighting.
What a name. How did we not get banned earlier?
I know. We totally forgot about that. Out fighting for the rights of a statue of Churchill or whatever. And yeah. I think it's like, because, like, war is obviously massively fetishized by this nation generally, because our entire history is built on empire and bloody, you know, nicking stuff and fighting around the world. And I think those Call of Duty games fill that weird fetishization void of young men who are like, they love all that serve your country army shit, but obviously they don't actually want to go do it. And those games fill a lot of that hole. Like, people sort of talk, like, I hear, like, I've played a few of them online. I've got a PlayStation now and I've played a few, and people actually are running around like using military terms. And actually, like, talking in, you know, talking about clicks, you know, he's two clicks north and all this shit.
All right.
And, like, and as well, it's like that same fetishization you see in, like, Andy McNab books, where he spends one line explaining the character of a woman, and then he spends 3.5 pages explaining the rubber grip of a Glock 17 or some shit. Like, it's all that weird military fetishization stuff. I think a lot of it stems from that. And yeah, it's the same. I think Call of Duty taps into all of that stuff on a very direct level. Like, you can be the sniper and catch the terrorist. And
yeah, it doesn't sit well with me.
No, I think they're shit games. I think they're so boring.
I think they're really boring. Like, and these non-skippable storylines that just go on.
I think video games where you can't skip cutscenes. There's a special place in hell next to Jimmy Savile for all the developers that made games where you can't skip the cutscenes.
Yeah.
It's
why GTA is so good. It's like, and I'm not a gamer. I actually just despise playing video games. But what I like about GTA is that the cutscenes are good, one, and two, you can always skip them.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like...
And it's that thing of, like, if you've got 20 minutes to just waste and you just want to play a bit of a game, if 14 minutes of that are, like, sort of B-list voice actors with sort of B-list animation, it's just a waste of time. No one cares. But, you know, if you want to watch it, fine, but there should always be a skip button.
Yeah.
It's just... But, yeah, so back to doing tricks on micro scooters. Fuck that. What a load of rubbish.
But it's not worth the
wait.
So people are taking this really seriously now. Like,
tricks are they doing? Like, Jackass style, like, we've put a firework on a micro scooter and now we're going to launch it off the back of a rhino?
There's one, if I can segue it in, I'll do it. Maybe for post-prod, I'll find it for you. But, like, there's this one of, like, this guy who's just, like, running up and down stairs like about 3 or 4 times, just like mentally trying to get in the space to do this jump. Then he like flies down this set of stairs and like loops the scooter over his head and back to his feet. And like, it looks impressive, but then you remember that it's just an 8-year-old scooter. And And it's like, I'm not impressed by that. You do look like a someone who's just stolen your daughter's, you know, wills.
Yeah, it's like someone who stepped it's like someone who stepped up the plate to do like a freestyle and just sort of recited the whole of Swallows and Amazons.
It's exactly that. It's like reading War and Peace to 7-year-olds.
But I notice around here, like I used to see it a bit in Hackney, like people going to work on micro scooters.
I mean, that upsets me.
And I'm like, just look, save up and get a Brompton, all right? You tight bastard.
When I worked in Putney, like they were fucking everywhere, literally everywhere. Like you could not walk without getting like knocked over by one or whatever. And it's like, there'd be like a family doing the school run on a micro scooter. So the mum or dad will be on a micro scooter or both. Then all the children will be on smaller ones.
They have their own.
Yeah.
Oh, no, I occasionally see like a dad or a mum coming home from the school run and like scooting home.
I've seen that too. Like, there's just, like, it's just, I don't know how I feel about it. I don't like adults on skateboards either.
No, well, we covered this with Lil Wayne last week. It just needs to stop.
I mean, I can settle with an adult on a BMX. It looks a bit silly, but it's fine because it is, a bicycle is an acceptable mode of transport to get around. Even though I will never be caught dead on one because I think they're incredibly dangerous and you will probably die if you ride one.
I forgot you're vehemently anti-bicycle.
Fucked. It's not so much that I'm anti-bicycle. It's more like, I know how I drive. I'm not changing that.
Yeah, you're definitely not changing your driving.
And I know how people cycle. And if anything, that's getting worse.
I think there's so many twat cyclists who are a law unto themselves. They just act like they ain't got to do shit.
And the difference is that I'll get caught for doing a wrong because I've got a number plate, whereas they won't because they haven't.
I mean, the middle classness of cycling just pissed me off. I just get fed up with people on Strava being like, oh, I've got my time down by 3 minutes. So I shaved my ball sack, so I'm aerodynamic. So, oh, shut the fuck up. No one cares.
Strava is a restaurant.
Say again?
Is Strava a restaurant?
Yes.
Good.
It's an Italian off London Fields.
Yeah, there's one in the Strand. Duffy. I remember I went for a job interview at the company that owns Nectar, the points loyalty company.
Ah.
Not the Amber Nectar.
What the hell were you going for a job interview with them for?
So this was pre-music, and I was really determined to get a job in corporate PR.
Right.
And that was going. It was kind
of...
Mate, I fucking love PR.
Why haven't you done anything for the label then?
No, because that's not the PR I like.
Oh,
the PR
that's helpful, isn't it, Ashley? That's worked out fucking neatly for
when
the
boys. When that does happen, you all know. Because the PR I like is crisis management.
Well, we've had plenty of them.
What? No, not that kind of. I mean, like
when not you say, our sort of crisis.
When you say something, that. The moment you say something racist, I'll be there to pick on the piece.
the minute Wade starts running his mouth, the old degree training will kick in.
Yes. So that stuff and corporate social responsibility, like the charity sort of stuff, I can wear that as well. But anything else, I'm just not into it.
Great.
It's the promotional stuff. I'm like, meh, I get it, but meh.
Yeah, it's pretty. I mean, it is pretty hollow. I feel you.
Mm.
It's all empty and vacant. On that note, should we fuck off?
Yeah. What should we end on?
I mean, what were we talking about, scooter tune.
That's one way to piss people off, yeah.
Yeah.
A scooter tune. There's like one, right?
I don't know. I don't fuck knows. I just remember the band Scooter. I don't know what they did.
What's the big one?
The Logic song is, I think, the big one.
Yeah, the Logical song, yeah.
Logical song, that's it. Or should we just end on the new E40 because it's actually really good?
Because okay,
we've just had Status Quo. We can't end on two shits.
Yeah, that's true. We can't end on two shits.
Get the Curb Commentator Volume 1, the new E40 and Sugar Free track.
Oh, the Sugar Free one. $19 lap dance.
And listen to Sugar Free's verse on this. It's an absolute gem. And by gem, I mean I'm not sure if it's good or not.
Steak, bitch, you're well past done. I got some news you can use. Some of you dudes playing football with basketball rules. It's game involved, don't try to compare it. Telling your side bitch all your business and she repeating it like a parrot. Don't get it twisted. Don't call me daddy, he'll call me your highness. If I stick my fist out, you better kiss it. I have her sprung like some dope. I have a bitch all in her emotions and choked up like the Trail Speedwell did his coach. You the baddest chick in the room. And I bet your coochie so good that it need to be trademarked. Legal Zoom. I'm trying to get rich. But see, you hard-headed and divisive. You want to be a vindictive bitch. I got the right of way. Bitch, get out there and get me my fetty so I can put it on my cousin books and JPEG.
I got $19 for a lap game. But I only got $1 for a cigarette. Look here. I got $19 for a lap game. But I only got $1 for a cigarette. Get it, get it now.
You had the same amount of time in the day as Raymond Simone, but you chose to be nobody. And who fronts you? You like the first piece of bread, bitch. Everybody want a sandwich, but nobody wants you. So pass the plate, cause bitch fucking with me. The only way you gonna get laid is to crawl up a chicken ass and wait. Hey, pimp of the year, vet. If you stay ready, you ain't gotta get ready. I sampled the bitch, but she ain't clear, Jack. Hey, it's too tight for you. My name's Sugar Free the Pimp, bitch, not Larry H. Parker. I won't fight for you. She hella into me. Got out of pocket one day, slapped her and asked her, what do you think of Einstein's theory of relativity? Hey, thicker than cash. I ain't lying, one day I wore all three pairs of kneecaps, kicking her ass. Get next to this. How I come down these flight of stairs on your ass like that bitch did on that.
I got 19.